Clipper Audio presents an unabridged recording of Woman on the Edge of Time by Marge Piercy, narrated by Tanya Eby.
Introduction to the 2016 edition. Why write a novel like Woman on the Edge of Time set in the future? The point of writing about the future is not to predict it. I'm not pretending to be Nostradamus. The point of such writing is to influence the present by extrapolating current trends for advancement or detriment. Nobody is good at prediction. If we were better at guessing events in a year or even a few months or weeks, our divorce rate would be zero. We would not get into stupid relationships, and nobody would lose money in the stock market or the racetrack. The point of creating futures is to get people to imagine what they want and don't want to happen down the road, and maybe do something about it. Woman on the Edge of Time was first published 40 years ago and begun 3.5 years before that. The early 1970s was a time of great political ferment and optimism among those of us who longed for change, for a more just and egalitarian society with more opportunities for all the people, not just some of them. Since then, inequality has greatly increased. As I write this, more people are poor. More people are working 2 or 3 jobs just to get by. More people find that their savings and their future have been wiped out by bad health or losing their jobs. The homeless are everywhere. Not just the single man or woman down on their luck or the shuffling bag lady, but whole families with their children. There is less opportunity for the children of ordinary people to afford college. If they can go, they will be dragging huge debt through much of their adult lives. Many working-class jobs that paid enough to buy and pay off a house, to hope for an even better life for their children, have been shipped overseas, where people even poorer than those who are losing those jobs will do them for pennies. Unions that protected workers have lost much of their clout and represent fewer workers each year. At the time I wrote this novel, women were making huge gains in control of their bodies and their lives. Not only has that momentum been lost, but many of the rights we worked so hard to secure are being taken from us by Congress and state legislatures every year. But we must also understand that the attempt to take away a woman's control over her body is part of a larger attempt to take away any real control over the lives of most of the population. Now, corporations and the very wealthy 1% control elections. Now, the media are propaganda machines, and the only investigative reporting is on Comedy Central, HBO, or the web. The powers that be have allowed for certain social rather than economic gains. We'll finally have legalized marijuana and gay marriage in every state while unions are being crushed and the safety net of the New Deal in the Johnson era is being abolished one law at a time, and women are forced into the back-alley abortions that once killed so many. We have made some social gains and many economic losses. The real earning power of working people diminishes every year. During the heyday of the second wave of the women's movement, a number of utopias were created. Joanna Russ's The Female Man, James Tiptree's Houston, Houston, Do You Read? Ursula K. Le Guin's The Dispossessed, Elizabeth Mann Borgese's My Own Utopia, From the Ascent of Woman, and Sally Miller Gearhart's The Wanderground, among a few. And now they aren't. Why? Feminist utopias were created out of a hunger for what we didn't have at a time when change felt not only possible, but probable. Utopias came from the desire to imagine a better society when we dared to do so. When our political energy goes into defending rights and projects we won and created now under attack, there is far less energy for imagining fully drawn future societies we might wish to live in. Writing about a strong community that socializes children and integrates old people is a product of women living in a society where a mother is alone with her children, who are often economically dependent on her alone, and which treats old women just a step better than the excess pets executed daily in pounds and shelters. We are ever more isolated from true intimate contact with one another. Many men prefer pornography to actual sex, where they have to please a woman, or must at least pretend to try. I have read my poetry to audiences where the students were each texting instead of listening or responding. I have sat at restaurant tables across from friends who were playing with their pads or phones or tablets. How many people do you see on the street walking blindly while talking on their smartphones? According to a recent poll, many people now report that their most intimate friends are their pets or personalities on TV. I also wanted the novel to show an ecologically sound society. The lives and institutions and rituals of Mattapoisett all stress being a part of nature and responsible for the natural world. In imagining the good society, I borrowed from all the progressive movements of that time. Like most women's utopias, Women on the Edge of Time is profoundly anarchist and aimed at integrating people back into the natural world and eliminating power relationships. The nuclear family is rare in feminist utopias and banished from this novel. Probably the most controversial part of Mattapoisett is the brooder, as many women felt they would be unwilling to give up birthing. If I had the book to write over again, I would include a group that chose to give birth live. In my original notes, I intended to, but during the long and complicated writing of the book, I never did put it in. Instead of slut-shaming, I projected a society in which sex was available, accepted, and non-hierarchical, and totally divorced from income, social status, power. No trophy wives, no closeting, no punishment or ostracism for preferring one kind of lover to another. No need to sell sex or buy it. No being stuck like my own mother in a loveless marriage because she had no way to support herself. In the dystopia in Woman on the Edge of Time, women are commodified, genetically modified, and powerless. Before beginning the novel, I read all the utopian fiction I could lay my hands on, partly to study the narrative strategies that had worked and those that were too static to compel a contemporary reader. I also read at least as many dystopian novels as utopian, perhaps more. Science fiction in the 50s was flooded with miserable post-nuclear Holocaust worlds, and I spent my adolescence reading a fair amount of those. The other genre I was working in was time travel. I was weary of affluent white males hogging the genre, and I did not feel that they were the sort of visitors I would prefer if I were a future good society. When I was a child, I first noticed that neither history, as I was taught it, nor the stories I was told, seemed to lead to me. I began to fix them. I have been at it ever since. We need a past that leads to us. Similarly, what we imagine we are working toward does a lot to define what we will consider doable action aimed at producing the future we want and preventing the future we fear. I was brought in undercover by people who worked in the mental institutions of the time so I could experience conditions inside. People risked their jobs to help me. Now, mental patients are dumped on the streets without support. We still drug, but we provide little counseling or safe and comfortable lodging. It's no improvement. I am always interested in who controls technology in any given society at a particular time. Who decides that trolleys and passenger trains are obsolete, but that cars are all important and our cities must be built around them as if they were the primary inhabitants? Who chooses which technology is explored? Who sets the rules for what is dangerous and what is acceptable risk? That it's important for taxpayers to subsidize nuclear power plants when there is no possible escape for people living near them when the inevitable accident occurs? For whose benefit are options explored? Who decides what is done and whom it is done to? How decisions are made in a fair and equalitarian way was one of the themes of the novel. I am also very interested in the socializing and interpersonal mechanisms of a society. How is conflict dealt with? Again, who gets to decide? And upon whose head and back are those decisions visited? How does that society deal with loneliness and alienation? How does it deal with getting born, growing up and learning, having sex, making babies, becoming sick and healing, dying and being disposed of? How do we deal with our collective memories, our history, that we are constantly reshaping? Utopia is born of the hunger for something better, but it relies on hope as the engine for imagining such a future. My desire to take what I considered the most fruitful ideas of the various movements for social change and make them vivid and concrete. That was the real genesis of Woman on the Edge of Time. Marge Piercy. 1. Connie got up from her kitchen table and walked slowly to the door. Either I saw him or I didn't, and I'm crazy for real this time, she thought. It's me, Dolly, her niece was screaming in the hall. Let me in, hurry. Momentito. Connie fumbled with the bolt, the police lock, finally swinging the door wide. Dolly fell in past her, her face bloody. Connie clutched at Dolly, trying to see how badly she was hurt. ¿Qué pasa? Who did this? Blood was oozing from Dolly's bruised mouth, and she grasped a wad of matted paper handkerchiefs brown with old blood and spotted bright red with fresh. Her left eye was swollen shut. Geraldo beat me. Dolly let her peel off the blue winter coat trimmed with fur and press her broad hips and pink pants back into the kitchen chair. There Dolly collapsed and began to weep. Awkwardly, Connie embraced her shoulders, her hands slipping on the satin of the blouse. The chair's warm, Dolly said after a few minutes. Give me a handkerchief. Connie brought toilet paper from the hall bathroom. She had nothing else, and carefully locked the outside door again. Then she put some of the good Dominican coffee she saved for special occasions into the drip pot and set water to boil in a kettle. It's cold in here, Dolly whimpered. I'll make it warmer. She lit the oven and turned on the burners. Soon, it'll be like that hothouse of yours. Geraldo beat you. Dolly opened her mouth wide, gaping. Lou, Lou. As gently as she could, she poked into Dolly's bloody mouth. Her own flesh cringed. Dolly jerked away. He broke a tooth, didn't he? That dirty, rotten pimp. Will I lose a tooth? I think you have one broken and maybe another loose, but who am I to say? I'm no dentist. You're still bleeding. He's crazy, that pig. He wants to mess me up. Connie, how come you wouldn't let me in? I was screaming in the hall forever. It wasn't 5 minutes. I thought I heard voices. Is somebody here? Dolly looked toward the other room, the bedroom. Who would be here? I had the TV on. It hurts so much. Give me something to kill the pain. Aspirin. Oh, come on. It hurts. Hija mia. How would I have anything? Connie lifted her hands to show them empty. Always empty. Those pills they made you take. From the state. Let me give you ice. Dolly had heard her talking with Luciente. Therefore he existed. Or Dolly had heard her talking to herself. Dolly had said the chair was warm. She had been sitting in the other chair in front of the plate from her supper of eggs and beans. She must not think about it now, with Dolly suffering. His story was unbelievable. No, don't think about it. She wrapped ice cubes in a kitchen towel and brought them to Dolly. That prescription ran out a year ago. Not that she had taken the tranquilizers. She had sold the pills for a little extra money, for a piece of pork or chicken once a week, soap to wash with. She found it hard to believe anybody would take that poison intentionally, but you could peddle any kind of pill in El Barrio. Still, there had been the nuisance of going down to Bellevue, since she had been living near Dolly's when she had been sent away and never could get her case transferred. Consuelo, Dolly leaned her swollen cheek on Connie's shoulder. Everything hurts. I'm scared. He punched me in the belly hard. Why do you stay with him? What good is he? With your daughter? Why have such a cabron hanging around? Dolly gave her the mocking glance that would greet any comment she might make for the rest of her life on the subject of the welfare of children. Or did she imagine it? Consuelo, I feel so sick. I feel lousy through and through. I have to lie down. Oh, if he makes me lose this baby, I'll kill him. As she supported her niece's weight into the bedroom, she felt a flash of fear, or perhaps of hope, that Luciente would still be there. But the tiny room held only her sway-backed bed, the chair with her alarm clock on it, the dresser, the wine jug full of dried flowers, the air shaft window incompletely covered with old curtains from better days. She undressed Dolly tenderly as a baby, but her niece groaned and cursed and wept more. The satin polka dot shirt was streaked with blood, and blood had soaked through her black satin brassiere with the nipples cut out. But it won't show on your nice bra, Connie promised, as Dolly mourned her clothes, her body, her skin. Bruises had already clotted under the velvety skin of Dolly's belly, her soft arms, her collarbone. Mira, is there blood on my panties? See if he made me bleed there. You aren't bleeding there, I promise. Get under the covers. Oye, Dolly, it isn't that easy to lose a baby. In the sixth month, if he beat you, maybe. But in the second month, that baby is better protected than you are. She put the alarm on the floor and sat in the straight chair beside the bed to hold Dolly's limp hand. Listen, I should take you to emergency. To Met. Don't make me go any place. I hurt too much. They can give you something for the pain. I'll get a gypsy cab to take us. It's only 15 blocks. I'm ashamed. What happened to you? Oh, my pimp beat up on me. In the morning, I'll go to my own dentist. You take me down to him in the morning. Otera on Canal. You call him up at 9:30 in the morning and tell him to take me right away. Now hold the ice against my cheek. Dolly, how do you know Geraldo won't come charging up here? Consuelo. Dolly drawled her name in a long wail of pain. Be nice to me. Don't push me around, too. I hurt. I want to rest. Be sweet to me. Give me a little yerba. It's in my purse, at the bottom of the cigarette pack. Dolly, you're crazy to run around with your face bleeding and dope in your purse. Suppose the cops pick you up. I had a lot of time to sort my purse when I was leaving. Come on, get it for me. She was fumbling through Dolly's big patent leather bag, clumsy prying in another woman's purse, when she heard heavy steps climbing. Men in a hurry. She froze. Why? Men ran up and down the steps of the tenement all night. But she knew. Geraldo pounded the door. She kept quiet. In the bedroom, Dolly moaned and began to weep again. Geraldo hit the door harder.
Open the door, you old bitch. Open or I'll break it down. Bust your head in. Come on. Open this fucking door.
He began kicking so hard the wood cracked and started to give way. He would break it down. She yelled, Wait, wait, I'm coming. Not a door opened in the hallway. Nobody came to look out. She undid the locks and hopped back before he could slam the door to the wall and crush her behind it. He strode in, thumping the door to the wall as she had known he would, followed by a scrawny older man in a buttoned-up gray overcoat and a hulking vato loco named Slick, she had seen with Geraldo before. They all crowded into her kitchen, and Geraldo slammed the door behind. Geraldo was Dolly's boyfriend. He had been a vendadero and done well enough, keeping Dolly and her little girl, Nita, from her marriage. But some squeeze in the drug trade had cut him off after he had been busted, although he had not ended up serving time. Now he made Dolly work as a prostitute, selling her body to all the dirty men in the city. He had three other girls that perhaps he had been running all the time on the side. Dolly made four. Connie hated him. It flowed like electric syrup through her veins how she hated him. Her hatred gave her a flush in the nerves like speed coming on. Geraldo was a medium-tall grifo, with fair skin, gray eyes, kinky hair, pelo alambre, that he wore in a symmetrical afro. He was elegant. Every time her eyes grated upon him, he was attired in some new costume of pimpish splendor. She dreamed of peeling off a sleekly polished antique lizard high-heeled boot and pounding it down his lying throat. She dreamed of yanking off his finger the large grayish diamond he boasted matching his scheming eyes and using it to slit his throat so his bad poisoned blood would run out.
Tia Consuelo, he crooned. Caca de puta, old bitch. Get your fat and worthless ass out of my way. Move.
Get out of my house. You hurt her enough. Get out.
Not anything like I'm going to hurt that bitch if she doesn't shape up.
The back of his arm striking like a rattlesnake, he shoved her into the sink. Then he strolled over to lounge, blocking the bedroom door. Always he was playing in some cold death's head mirror, watching himself, polishing his cool.
Hey, cunt, stop blubbering. I brought you a doctor.
What kind of doctor?
Connie shrieked. She had slid under his blow and caught only the edge of the sink. She cowered, half crouching.
A butcher. That's what kind of doctor. That bughouse taught you all about doctors, huh?
He will leave her alone, Geraldo. She wants to have your baby so bad. She can stay with me.
So you can cut it up, you nut. Now turn it off or Slick will bust your lip.
Geraldo leaned on the doorframe, lighting a cigarette and dropping the lit match on the floor, where it slowly burned out, making a black hole in the worn linoleum.
Time to rise and fly. I brought a doctor to fix you. Up now. Move.
No, I don't want him to touch me. Geraldo, honey, I want this baby.
What shit's you pushing? You think I sweat bricks for the kid of some stupid trick with dragging balls? You don't even know what color worm you got turning in the apple.
It's your baby. It is. In Puerto Rico, I didn't take my pills.
Woman, so many men been into you. It could have a whole subway car of daddies.
In San Juan, I never took my pills. I told you already.
You tell me? Not in this life, baby. How you pass the time while I was busy in La Perla, huh?
He flicked lint from his vest.
You wouldn't take me to meet your family.
Geraldo had taken Dolly with him on vacation. Connie felt pretty sure Dolly had tried to get pregnant, believing that Geraldo would let her quit whoring. Dolly wanted to have another baby and stay home, like figures of paper, like a manger scene of pasteboard figures. A fantasy had shown in Connie since her conversation with Dolly that morning. She and Dolly and Dolly's children would live together. She would have a family again. Finally. She would be ever so careful and good. She would do anything, anything at all to keep them together. She would never be jealous of her niece, no matter how many boyfriends she had. Dolly could stay out all night and go off on weekends and to Florida even, and she would stay with Nita and the baby. As if anyone would ever again leave her alone with a child. The dream was like those paper dolls. The only dolls she had had as a child, dolls with blonde paper hair and Anglo features and big paper smiles. That she knew in her heart of ashes the dream was futile did not make it less precious. Every soul needs a little sweetness. She thought of the stalks of sugarcane the kids bought at the fruit and vegetable man. Sweet in the mouth as you chewed it, and then you spat out the husks and they lay in the street. Hollow, flimsy, for a moment sweet in the mouth. Cane with which her grandmother had sweetened the chocolate long ago in El Paso.
Shut off that fucking kettle!
Geraldo shouted at her, and she jumped to put out the flame. The coffee she had never finished making. The kettle had boiled almost dry. She shut off the oven and the burners, because now her two small rooms felt stifling hot. How she had jumped to the stove when he rapped out that curt command. She resented obeying him automatically, instinctively jerking at the loud masculine order. His beauty only made him more hateful.
His face, with the big gray eyes, the broad nose, the full, cruel mouth, the hands like long talons, the proud bearing. He was the man who had pimped her favorite niece, her baby, the pimp who had beaten Dolly and sold her to pigs to empty themselves in, who robbed Dolly and slapped her daughter Nita and took away the money squeezed out of the pollution of Dolly's flesh to buy lizard boots and cocaine and other women. Geraldo was her father, who had beaten her every week of her childhood, her second husband, who had sent her into emergency with blood running down her legs. He was El Muro, who had raped her and then beaten her because she would not lie and say she had enjoyed it. She had had the strength then to run, to cut her losses and run. On the evening bus the next day, she had left her home in Chicago, her father's and sister's, the graves of her mother and her first, her real husband, Martin. Dolly lacked the coarse strength that had saved her that time. But Dolly had Nita already and a baby in the oven. "Fiate, Geraldo," she screamed. "She's carrying your child. She came back that way from San Juan. I told her she was carrying the first time I saw her back here. What kind of tailless wonder are you to have your own child butchered by that doctor of dogs?" Pivoting, Geraldo cuffed her back into the stove. The hot metal seared her back in a broad line, and she clamped her lips tight, unable to scream, unable to issue a sound from the suddenness of the pain. She sank to the floor and could not speak or move.
"Puta, get up and go with Dr. Medias, or I'll have him do it on you right in that witch's bed. Move!"
"No, no." Dolly was thrashing around in bed, screaming and sobbing. Geraldo stepped into the bedroom, out of Connie's line of sight. She tried to roll to her feet. The scrawny doctor sat on the edge of a kitchen chair. He was in his 50s. His clothes were new and conservative. His manner was tense, and his foot tapped, tapped. Slick was leaning against the outer door, smoking a joint and grinning. Connie asked in Spanish, "You are really a doctor?"
"Of course."
He did not look at her, but replied as softly as she spoke. At his accent, her eyes narrowed. "Where are you a doctor?" She rolled on one elbow and tried to rise. "My back hurts me. It's burned so bad. You're Mexican."
"What is it to you?"
"Where are you from?"
"Mexico City."
"No. From Chihuahua, no?"
"Leave me alone, woman. You ask for trouble."
"From you? You have enough troubles, practicing medicine without a license. Why do you want to hurt us? My parents, too, came from Chihuahua."
"Chihuahua can sink in a pit."
"Her father's a businessman in New Jersey. He has a big nursery business. Did that stinking pimp tell you? If you do this thing, her father will make trouble for you. It's the truth." Dolly let out a long, terrified wail that scraped on the inside of Connie's skull. She had not heard such a desperate scream since she had been in the bug house.
Geraldo called Dr. Medias.
Medias rose slowly to his feet and fumbled for a bag he had set beside the chair. Connie pulled herself up by the table leg, kicked him as hard as she could in the shin, and ran into the bedroom. She must stop them. Dolly's mouth was bleeding again. Blood ran over the tattered nightgown Connie had dressed her in, onto the pillow. Dolly was trying to thrash free of Geraldo, who held her pinned. He would kill her. With his treachery, he would kill Dolly and her baby, too. Dolly would bleed to death in that bed. Connie seized a bottle from the corner, the wine bottle that had once contained a half gallon of California Burgundy, and now held dried flowers and grasses, from a rare picnic with Dolly, Nita, Luis, Dolly's father and her brother, and his current family. With the nostalgic grasses scattering, she waved the jug and ran at Geraldo. He did not let go of Dolly quick enough to defend himself. She smashed the wine jug right into his face. His nose flattened like a squashed bug on a windshield. He fell back against the wall, bellowing rage in no language. She raised the jug to hit him again, but her arms were caught behind her. She twisted.
Someone struck her hard in the nape and she tried to run. The fist caught her again and she went out. She lay tied with straps to a bed, staring up at a bare bulb, shot up with meds. Thorazine? It felt worse, heavier, a massive dose. Hospital tranks hit her like a bulldozer when she had taken nothing for a long time. Prolixin? Whenever she sank into unconsciousness, she was tortured by clamps on her hips, her breasts. She was trapped in her old Chicago flat in a fire. The flames licked her skin, her lungs filled with choking smoke. She tried and tried to pull clear of something that had fallen on her to escape. She could not move. Her body ached. All of her head ached. Geraldo and his carnal slick had beaten her twice. Once right after she had broken Geraldo's nose, and again on the way to Bellevue in his car. Her ribs hurt terribly on the right side, and she suspected one or two might be broken. Probably Geraldo had kicked her as she lay on the floor. In the car she had come to, and he had begun punching her again in the face and chest and arms. He had beaten her until Dolly begged him to stop and began to weep and threatened to jump out of the car. Each breath she drew stabbed her. How could she get the hospital to x-ray her for a broken hip? So far no one had heard a word she said, which of course was not unusual. Geraldo was so damned smart, bringing her to Bellevue, for instance, instead of to Met on 96th. Bellevue had records on her from before. He pretended she had attacked him and Dolly at Dolly's apartment on Rivington. He would take no chance that they might not accept her as a crazy woman. The doctor had not even interviewed her, but had talked exclusively to Geraldo, exchanging only a word or two with Dolly. Geraldo had Dolly gripped by the elbow, her face still swollen. Dolly had lied. Dolly had sold her into Bellevue. And for what? For her own skin, already polluted? For the nose of her precious pimp? For the opportunity to fuck more Johns? How could Dolly sit there sniveling and nod when the doctor asked if Connie had done that to her face? Connie writhed on the bed, pinned down with just enough play to let her wriggle. They had pushed her into restraint, shot her up immediately. She had been screaming. Okay, did they think you had to be crazy to protest being locked up? Yes, they did. They said reluctance to be hospitalized was a sign of sickness, assuming you were sick in one of these no-win circles. The last time she had not fought, she had come willingly with the caseworker, believing in her sickness. She had come humbly, rotten with self-hatred and weary of her life. Her left calf began to cramp. She wanted to shriek with the sharp pain. She longed to knead the calf in her hands. The hard ball of muscle formed and held rigid. If she screamed, they might never release her from restraint. They had forgotten her, locked her away in this broom closet to starve. She had pissed on herself. What could she do? Now she lay in her own wet stink. Cold at first, creepy cold. Now warm from her body and stinking. She turned her head, craning to watch the slit in the door, wide and low. Like a mouth. If only she saw an attendant look in, she could signal. Her back festered between her shoulder blades, where it had been burned by the stove. The two attendants had put her neatly into restraint, the injection entering her veins like molten lead. Folding a sheet warm from the machine in the laundry room, flip, flip, bang, fold. Already the processing had begun. The attendant at check-in had held by one corner her worn red plastic purse mended with tape. Held it like something dirty, a piece of garbage from the streets. Casually, the woman arrayed her fragile possessions on the counter and, with a gesture like emptying an ashtray, dropped them into an envelope and locked them away. Her purse, her keys, her scrap of brown paper on which she had been figuring April's budget, her rent receipt, the ballpoint pen with the name of a stationery company that she had found in the subway, her black plastic comb, her old loved compact with the raised peacock figure that Claude had given her for her birthday, selecting with his sensitive fingers the look of the design, her dime store red lipstick that she wore only for best against the day when it would be used up and she would lack the money for another. Unless Dolly gave her lipstick. Dolly, who had betrayed her, who had abandoned her, who had sold her into bondage. At the desk, her counters of identity had been taken, welfare ID, Medicaid, old library card, photos of Dolly with Nita, of Angelina as a baby, at one held by her father, Eddie, at two with herself, at three holding Claude's hand with that grin like a canoe, the way she had drawn mouths. There were no pictures of Angelina at four, or afterward. Through some bond of blood like a ghostly umbilical cord, could Angelina in Larchmont or Scarsdale feel her mother on the rack? Her back hurt so, her calf ached, her face throbbed, her ribs stabbed her as she breathed. Her shoulder was wounded where Geraldo had twisted her arm in the back seat of the car until she had thought it would snap. Her tongue was swollen, and her mouth full of blood as Dolly's had been. A foul taste. Herself. The smell of her own piss rose into her nostrils. She began to weep. Then she choked on her tears and stopped in panic. She could not wipe her nose. The tears ran into her mouth. She was trussed like a holiday bird for the oven. That doctor. What was his name? Youngish, with fine, thin brown hair worn straggling. Not quite long, not quite short. He kept yawning and trying to suppress the yawns so that his jaw muscles flexed strangely as he questioned Geraldo and wrote entries on a record form. Geraldo was almost demure. He had a good manner with authority, as any proper pimp should, respectful but confident. Man to man, pimp and doctor discussed her condition while Dolly sobbed. The doctor asked her only her name and the date. First, she said it was the 14th, and then she changed it to the 15th, thinking it must be after midnight. She had no idea how long she had been unconscious. "Listen to me, doctor. I didn't hit her. You take my niece into another room away from him and ask her if I hit her. He hit her." The doctor went on making notations on the form. She was a body checked into the morgue, meat registered for the scales. She tried to tell the nurse who gave her the injection, the attendants who tied her to the stretcher, that she was innocent, that she had a broken rib, that Geraldo had beaten her. It was as if she spoke another language. That language Claude's buddy had been learning that nobody else knew. Yoruba. They acted as if they couldn't hear you. If you complained, they took it as a sign of sickness. The authority of the physician is undermined if the patient presumes to make a diagnostic statement. She had heard a doctor say that to a resident, teaching him not to listen to patients. She had been through that last time in, when she had had a toothache. It had developed into a full abscess before the nurse and the attendants stopped interpreting her complaints as part of her pattern of illness behavior. Fool. Poor fool, she had got herself locked away again. She had jumped into the fire. Why had she done it? Why? Yet lying in enforced contemplation, she found that clean anger glowing in her still. She hated Geraldo, and it was right for her to hate him. Attacking him was different from turning her anger, her sorrow, her loss of Claude into self-hatred, into speed and downers, into booze, into wine, into seeing herself in Angelina and abusing that self born again into the dirty world. Yes, this time was different. She had struck out not at herself, not at herself and another, but at Geraldo, the enemy. She had not been wrong to try to defend Dolly, her closest one now, her blood, her almost child. How could she allow Geraldo to carve up Dolly's body? She had smashed his nose, yes. For all her pain, she smiled as she saw that moment. She had smashed his nose, and he would never look quite the same. Last time in, she had accepted the doom of sickness. The weight of the heavy judgment they passed out here she had bowed to. This time, she was not ashamed. She would get out fast. She would be clearly competent, sane, together. How long did she lie strapped to the bed?
Day was the same as night. They had forgotten her, and she would die here in her own piss. Sometimes she could not stand it anymore, and she yelled as loud as she could and begged the walls to open. Moments were forever. She was mad. The drugs made her mind strange. She was caught. She was stalled. She floated, trapped like an embryo in alcohol. That awful thing the Right to Life people had in that van on the street. She was caught in a moment that had fallen out of time and would never be over, never be done. She was mad. Yes, now she was crazy. How could she doubt it? Lying wet in her own piss while her body screamed and the drug thickened her to lead. Sometimes she slipped down into a hot, muggy doze, and sometimes a pain from her back or her rib or her mouth tore through her sleep, and she woke wild with grief and wept.
Please, please, please come. Please let me out. Someone, please.
No response came. That was madness. To weep and cry out and curse and scream, and it was as if she had done nothing. She was dozing in that feverish half-sleep without rest or relief when the door banged open. Two attendants came in and untied her. She pitched forward, weak as string. She could see in their faces disgust, boredom. She smelled bad. She stank. They hauled her along the hall like a bag of garbage, and they paid no attention to what she tried to say.
Please, I beg of you, listen. I was beaten before they brought me here. My rib hurts so much. Please, listen.
So I said to her, it's all right for you. You don't have to deal with these animals all day.
The woman was a husky dyed blonde who spoke with a slight Middle European accent.
All you do is come in 2 days and play games with the better ones. It's easy for you to pass remarks.
Those OTs have it easy. The other woman was 6 feet tall, hefty and black.
You better believe it. We just don't live right, Annette. We just the muscle around here.
But Bird gives me a pain. She's no better than she ought to be. You know, she lives with a man she's not married to.
Lives with him openly in an apartment in Chelsea.
The black woman wore a bland, noncommittal look.
Here, into the bath with you, Snooks,
she said to Connie from over her head. They began pulling her clothes off.
I can undress myself.
Ooh, me oh my, is this one a mess. Did she jump out the window or something?
I was beaten up by a pimp, not mine, she added quickly. He was beating my niece. It's him who brought me here.
Now what have you been into?
The black attendant wondered, shoving her into the shower like a dog to be bathed.
Some gorgeous bruises you got yourself.
She'll smell better when she gets out.
You wonder how they can live with themselves, never washing. But that's part of being sick,
the blonde said loftily. Probably she's been sleeping in the street, in doorways. I see them around. She wanted to scream that she washed as often as they did, that they had made her smell, made her dirty herself. But she did not dare. First, they would not listen. And second, they might hurt her. Who would care? Because her clothes were filthy, they gave her a pair of blue pajamas 3 sizes too big and a robe of no particular color. Rotten luck to have been shoved into restraint on arrival. If she had simply walked up to the ward, she would have been able to keep her street clothes and more things. Here, a scrap of paper, a book, a handkerchief, a nubbin of pencil, a bobby pin were precious beyond imagining outside. Irreplaceable treasures. She found herself walking strangely. Not only from the bruises. Ah, the old Thorazine shuffle. She could no longer move quickly, gracefully, in spite of her plumpness. The black attendant walked her into the day room, a big, bleak room between the men's and the women's sides of the ward, right by the locked door to the hall and the elevators. She looked around, slowly. She caught sight of a clock on the way in, and she knew it was 11 in the morning. She was not hungry, although she had not eaten for a long time. The drug killed her appetite, so that she felt hollow, weak, but not hungry. The rib stabbed her. She felt feverish, and might be. Nothing she could do.
Her only hope was to catch a doctor as he made his flight through the ward, or to persuade one of the attendants that she really needed medical help. Then the attendant would tell the doctor. It would take days to reach that kind of relationship with an attendant, and in the meantime, she could die. How hot the ward was. Steam heat from the old radiators turned on full blast. She fingered the plastic identification bracelet sealed on her wrist. Women in street clothes or the hospital clothes issued to them were sitting vacantly along the walls or staring at the television set placed up on a shelf where no one could reach it to change the station or alter the volume level. It was less crowded than when she had been in last, markedly so. Just opposite her, two old women were chatting animatedly in strong Brooklyn Jewish accents, like two gossips on a park bench instead of two mad women on a plastic bench in a mental hospital. But they might only be elderly and not mad. At their feet, a young girl lay motionless with her hands over her face, like a pet dog snoozing. There were less old women this time. Was there a new wastebasket for the old? Four Puerto Rican men were playing dominoes with bits of paper at a card table in a slow motion brought on by all of them being heavily drugged, like everybody else. The game seemed to occur underwater. A child, a boy of 8 or 9, sat near them picking his nose in the same kind of slow motion with such a look of blank despair on his small face, she had to turn away. Most of the women were sitting on the plastic chairs that came in ranks of 4 against the wall, but there were more women than chairs. Though some were old, some children, some black, some brown, some white, they all looked more or less alike and seemed to wear a common expression. She knew that in a short while this ward, like every other she had been on, would be peopled by strong personalities, a web of romances and feuds and strategies for survival. She felt weary in advance. Who needed to be set down in this desolate limbo to survive somehow in the teeth of the odds? She had had enough troubles already. Enough. Lunch, ladies, lunch. Line up now. Come on, get your asses moving, ladies. The dining room was around a bend in the corridor in the same ward. Back and forth they went. Back and forth in the confined space from doorless bathroom to dining room to seclusion, called treatment rooms here, to the dormitories to the day room. Lunch was a gray stew and an institutional salad of celery and raisins in orange jello. The food had no flavor except the sweet of the jello, and she had to eat it all with a plastic spoon. At least the food did not need chewing in her bloody mouth. The objects in the stew were mushy, bits of soft flotsam and jetsam in lukewarm glue. She tried to think about how to get out of here, but her mind was mud. Lunch was over in 15 minutes, and then they were back in the day room, milling around to line up for medication. She needed her wits to plot how she would get out of here. The effects of the shot had not worn off. Then she held her face rigid when she saw the paper cup with the pills. Gracias, gracias. A pill was easily dealt with, unlike the liquid you had to swallow at once. She slipped it under her tongue, swallowed the water, and sat down on an orange chair. It did not do to head too quickly for the bathroom to spit out the pill. She kept it under her tongue till the coating wore off, and she began to taste the bitter drug. Visiting hour came in mid-afternoon. Hope stabbed her when the attendant came to say she had a visitor. Dolly! Dolly was heavily made up. She was not wearing her fur-collared coat, but her old red belted coat Connie remembered from the year when Dolly was married and carrying Nita. Dolly, get me out of here. Honey, I can't just yet. Be a little patient. By the middle of next week. Dolly, por favor. No puedo vivir en esto hoyo. Hija mija, ayúdame. Dolly chose to reply in English. It's just for a couple of days, Connie. Not like last time. Politely reminding her that to be locked up in a mental institution was something she should be accustomed to. Dolly, how could you say I hit you? Me? Geraldo? He made me.
She lowered her voice. Did you have the operation?
I'm going into the hospital Monday.
Dolly fluffed her hair.
I persuaded him not to use that butcher on me. It costs a lot, but it will be a real hospital operation. Not with that butcher who does it on all the whores cheap.
Dolly spoke with pride. Connie shrugged, her mouth sagging.
You could leave town.
Daddy won't let me have the baby either. That old. Dolly picked at her cuticle, ruining the smooth line of the crimson polish. I did ask him. He says he washes his hands of me. Listen, Connie. If I have the operation, Geraldo promises I can quit. He'll marry me. We'll have a real wedding next month, soon as I'm better from the operation. So you see, things are working out okay. And just as soon as I come out of the hospital, I'll get you out. It's only for a week. Please, Dolly, take me out before you go in for the operation. Please, I can't stand it here.
I can't.
Dolly shook her head. He really busted his nose. He's going to have an operation himself. It's going to cost a bundle, Consuelo. He looks awful with a bandage all over his nose. He looks like a bird. Like a crazy eagle with that big beak in the middle of his face. Dolly began to giggle, covering her mouth with her hand. Connie smiled painfully. I'm glad I hid him.
Well,
Dolly turned her eyes up. I guess they can fix him with plastic surgery. He really lit into him. Mama, how you slammed him with that wine bottle? I thought he'd kill you.
I wish I had killed him, Connie said, very, very softly. How can you care about him with your face still swollen from his beating?
He is my man, Dolly said, shrugging. What can I do?
Listen, can you bring me some clothes and stuff here before you go in the hospital?
When blocked, maneuver to survive, the first rule of life inside.
Sure. What you want? Tomorrow I'll bring it to you. Around this time.
She went into the bathroom after Dolly left and stayed there as long as she dared. Stalls without doors. In spite of the stink, it was a place to be almost alone, precious in the hospital. How could she scream at Dolly? What use? Dolly chose to believe Geraldo, and if she tried to shake that belief, Dolly would only turn from her. Then Dolly would not help her to get out, would not bring her clothing and the small necessities that could make the passing hollow days a little more bearable. She judged her niece for choosing Geraldo over her unborn baby and over herself. But hadn't she chosen to mourn for Claude almost to death? Outside, did rain slick First Avenue? Was the sun bleeding through a murky overcast? Was it a rare blue day when the building stood crisp against the sky? Here it was time for meds. Here it was time to line up for a paper cup of mouthwash. Here it was time to line up for all starch meals. Here it was time to line up for more meds. Here it was time to sit and sit and sit. Here it was time to greet a familiar black face from the last time.
Yeah, I was brought in 3-4 days ago, Connie told her. Been here long?
My caseworker brought me in Monday, same as last time. You too?
Connie bowed her head.
Yeah, it was my caseworker.
Here it was time to sit facing a social worker, Miss Ferguson, who looked at the records spread out on her desk rather than at her. Miss Ferguson sat tightly, and occasionally she glanced toward the door.
You don't have to be nervous about me, Connie said. I didn't do what Geraldo the pimp said. I didn't hit my niece. I wouldn't hurt one hair on her head.
Him I hit, that's the truth. I only hit him because he was beating her up.
Was that how it was with your daughter? Miss Ferguson had light brown hair, curled at the ends. She wore granny glasses and a pale blue pantsuit. A pimple had broken out on the end of her nose that her right hand kept stealing up to touch.
It isn't the same this time. It isn't.
How can we help you if you won't let us? Miss Ferguson glanced at her wristwatch, shuffling the papers in the folder. Her folder.
3 years ago, you were admitted to Bellevue on the joint recommendation of a social worker from the Bureau of Child Welfare, your caseworker from welfare, and your parole officer. You were then hospitalized at Rockover State for 8 months. They said I was sick, and I agreed. Someone close to me had died, and I didn't want to live. You have a history of child abuse. Once, I was sick. Your parental rights were terminated. Your daughter, Angelina Ramos, was put out for adoption. I should never have agreed to that. I didn't understand what was happening. I thought they were just going to take care of her. It was the clinical judgment of the court psychiatrist that your daughter would be better off with foster parents. The pimple was growing as she watched. Miss Ferguson kept feeling it gingerly, poking it while pretending not to. They were wrong to take my daughter. She saw Miss Ferguson frown. Imagine, your daughter. I hurt her once. That was a terrible thing to do, I know it. But to punish me for it the rest of my life? The social worker was giving her that human-to-cockroach look. Most people hit kids. But if you were on welfare and on probation, and the whole social pigeonholing establishment had the right to trek regularly through your kitchen, looking in the closets and under the bed, counting the bedbugs and your shoes, you had better not hit your kid once. The abused and neglected child, they had called Angelina officially. She had been mean to Angie. She had spent those months after she got the news about Claude's death, gulping downs, drinking bad red wine. A couple of times, she had shot speed. She had thought nothing could hurt her anymore, until she lost Angelina. Maybe you always have more to lose until, like Claude, they took your life, too. The acquaintance who died, that would be your... the black, handicapped pickpocket whose assistant you were. Her face slammed shut. They trapped you into saying something, and then they'd bring out their interpretations that made your life over, to make your life into a pattern of disease. Couldn't even say blind. Handicapped? He wasn't. He was a fine saxophone player. He was a talented pickpocket, and he brought home good things for her and her baby. He had been as good to Angie as if she had been his own baby daughter. He had been good to her, too. A loving man. The sweetest man she had ever had. As if Claude could be summoned up in their rotten records, either the sweetness or the pain of him, his badass fury. They had killed him, too. In prison, he had taken part in a medical experiment for the money and hoping to shorten his time. They had injected him with hepatitis, and the disease had run its course and he had died. Her probation officer, Briggs, would not let her go to the funeral. That bastard. Did he think they would plot together, him from his closed coffin? The Puerto Rican man you describe as your niece's pimp, is that the same as her fiancé? He is her pimp. That's how he makes a living. He has 3 other girls. Connie sat forward, giving up. Don't try to win now. Just survive. Look, please, Miss Ferguson, look at my mouth where he hit me. Would you look at me, please? Just for one moment? My side, here. It hurts awful. After they knocked me down, he kicked me while I was lying on the floor. When I breathe, each time, all the time, it hurts. I think... She was about to say that her rib was broken or cracked, but they got nasty if you said anything medical. I think something's wrong inside me, where he kicked me on the floor. Who are the they you believe knocked you down? Is that your niece, Dolores Campos? No. He came in with, She realized she didn't want to say doctor. How careful she had to be with them. With a couple of pals, hoodlums. When I hit him, they knocked me down. You do admit you remember that you struck him. Yes, he was beating Dolly. Your niece says you attacked her. She told me he made her say that. Ask her in a room alone. I beg you. Ask her alone. She's scared to go against Geraldo. her hands clasped in the gesture of praying, and she heard her own voice whining, "Please, Miss Ferguson, have a doctor look at me. I hurt so much. Please, I beg you, look at my mouth."
"You say it hurts you. Where do you believe you feel pain?"
"In my side, my ribs, also my mouth, and my back is burned. Those are the worst places. The rest is just bruises."
"In your side?"
"It hurts every breath I take. Please?"
"Well, you do have bruises. All right, I'll speak to the nurse."
Miss Ferguson caressed her pimple, pretending to adjust her glasses. With a nod, she dismissed Connie.
Finally, on Tuesday, Connie was x-rayed, and her cracked rib was taped, and her mouth looked at. They sent her with an attendant to the dentist. She missed visiting hour, so she did not find out whether Dolly was out of the hospital yet. But tomorrow, surely, Dolly must come and talk to them about releasing her. If she could get Dolly to tell the truth to the doctor, the nurse, even to the social worker, then they would let her go. Even figuring the whole process of release would take a day or two, she could be out by Friday night.
She sat in a lopsided chair in the hall outside the dentist's office, with the attendant beside her poring over an astrology magazine. How she would celebrate her release! Her dingy two rooms with the toilet in the hall shone in her mind, vast and luxurious after the hospital. Doors she could shut, a toilet with a door, chairs to sit in, a table of her own to eat on, a TV set that she could turn on and off and tune to whatever program she wanted to watch, her own bed with clean sheets and no stink of old piss, her precious freedom and privacy. Yes, she would rise in the morning when she wanted to, instead of when the attendant came yelling. No more Thorazine and sleeping pills. The brief high and the endless sluggish depths. Nights of sleep with real dreams. She would go hungry for a week for the pleasure of eating a real orange, an avocado. All day long, nobody would tell her what to do. Miraculously, she would walk through the streets without an attendant. She would breathe the beautiful, living, filthy air. She would walk until she felt like sitting down. Around her kitchen, she would sing and dance. She would sing love songs to the cucarachas and the chinchis, her chinchis. Her life that had felt so threadbare now spread out like a full red velvet rose. The rose that Claude had once brought her, loving it for its silkiness, its fragrance, and not knowing it was dark red. Her ordinary, penny-pinching life appeared to her full beyond the possibility of savoring every moment. A life crammed overflowing with aromas of coffee, of dope smoke in hallways, of refried cooking oil as she climbed the stairs of her tenement, of the fragrance of fresh-cut grass and new buds in Central Park, sidewalk vendors, cuchifritos, the spring rhythm of conga drums through the streets. Waiting in the rickety chair for the dentist, her mouth filled with saliva, and she glanced with envy at the coffee the attendant was sipping. White coffee, probably sweet too. To make conversation, she asked, "What sign are you?" The woman gave her a sideways glance.
"Sagittarius." She had no idea when that was.
"I'm Aries."
"Your sign is cuckoo, girl."
The attendant went back to her magazine, turning slightly away. She would be out soon, soon. Swallow all insults. Keep quiet. She would have better things than coffee from a coffee machine. She would make herself the pot of Dominican coffee she had started that night for Dolly. She had such a hunger for Mexican cooking. Puerto Rican food was different. She had learned to eat it, to like it. In fact, she had cooked salcocho, mondongo, asopao, and many platanos dishes for Eddie. For Dolly, too, whose mother, Carmel, was Puerto Rican. But even the staples were not the same. All those root vegetables, yucca, yawlin, taro, the salt codfish, bacalao, instead of the base of corn and beans. She had grown up on pintos, and the Puerto Ricans ate more black beans. She had noticed a few Mexican restaurants around New York, but they were too expensive for her. Ridiculous to live in a place where the taste of your own soul food was priced beyond you. She got to eat Chinese oftener than Mexican. To breathe the air of freedom would be enough. She had not handled the interview well with Ferguson. She would talk about getting a job. She could even try again, trekking from office to office. Maybe she had given up too easily. Maybe she could get temporary office work. Maybe at least she could persuade the social worker that she would. They liked that, if you could persuade them you were going to get a job. She thought of Ferguson and shrugged. Chances were, it would be a different one next time anyhow. She hadn't typed in 4 years, 5 years. Last time in, she had applied for a typing job, but they liked to use the younger women. Maybe they had a machine here she could practice on. She had to figure the angles. Best if she could manage to believe it herself that she could get a job. Herself with a police record and a psychiatric record. A fat Chicana aged 37, without a man, without her own child, without the right clothes, with her plastic pocketbook cracked on the side and held together with tape. The dental assistant pitter-pattered out to summon them, and the attendant hauled her up like a rag doll and marched her in for treatment. Wednesday and Thursday went by like long, long freight trains, and finally Friday came. On her ward, two patients had weekend passes to go home. Three other women were being discharged. Their effects came up in bags, and their relatives took them away. More women were brought up. Dolly did not come for her. Then the nurse, whistling a song with a Latin beat that had been on all the stations lately, even the white stations, stopped and spoke to her. "All right, Mrs. Ramos, get yourself together."
"I'm getting out. I knew it. I'm getting out, right?"
"You're going to the country. Trees and green grass. For a rest like you need."
"Don't hand me that."
She clutched herself.
"You can't send me up. I'm only in for observation."
"Your family wants you to get well, just as the doctor does."
"The doctor only spoke to me for 5 minutes.
"You're a sick woman. Everybody wants you to get well again," the nurse said with that false sweetness.
"Don't you want to get well?"
"Who's signing me in? Did my niece do this?" "Your brother, Louis. So you won't hurt yourself or anyone else. You've been a bad girl again, Mrs. Ramos."
"Where are you sending me?"
"You just get your things together. You'll find out." The nurse strolled off whistling that catchy song by War that had been echoing in El Barrio for weeks. The rain came down hard. The day was clammy, and gusts of wind splashed the water in breaking waves against the closed sides of the ambulance bus. She sat so that she could see out through the slit, wearing her own clothes that Dolly had brought her. Rain drummed on the metal roof, assaulting it. Underwater, she was drowning. Here she was with her life half spent, midway through her dark journey that had pushed her into the hands of the midwife in El Paso, and carried her through the near west side of Chicago, through the Bronx, and the lower east side and El Barrio. The Iron Maiden was carrying her to rock over again. Luis had signed her in. A bargain had been struck. Some truce had been negotiated between the two men over the bodies of their women. Luis, who never admitted his oldest daughter was a whore, but made her feel like one whenever he got her in his house. The Iron Maiden jounced roughly on, battering her. Halfway through the hard years allotted women, she found herself stymied, trapped, drugged with the Thorazine that sapped her will and dulled her brain and drained her body of energy. She had lost some weight, and the old yellow dress hung loosely. Her lips and her nails were split from the drug and lack of protein. The dentist had yanked a tooth and filled two others in quick repair. Her rib ached. The tape was tight around her like a corset under the loose dress. Into the unnatural darkness of the April storm, she was carried blind in the belly of the iron beast. The ambulance bus slowed abruptly, making sharp turns, slowing down again. She pressed her eye to the slit and stared at the budding trees, the hedges. At length, she saw through the blowing veil of the rain the walls she knew too well, that place of punishment, of sorrow, of the slow or fast murder of the self, called Rockover State. Perhaps she deserved punishment for the craziness none had guessed, the questions no one had asked, the story no one had pried from her, that all of the month before she had been hallucinating with increasing sharpness, a strange man, that she had dreamed and then waking dreamed and finally seen on the streets that same smooth Indio face. Then the gate swallowed the ambulance bus and swallowed her as she left the world and entered the underland, where all who were not desired, who caught like rough teeth in the cogwheels, who had no place or fit crosswise, the one they were hammered into, were carded to repent of their contrariness or to pursue their mad vision down to the pit of terror. Into the asylum that offered none, the broken-springed bus roughly galloped. Over the old buildings, the rain blew in long, gray, ropey strands, cascading down the brick walls. As she was beckoned out with rough speed, she was surprised to see gulls wheeling above, far inland, as over other refuse grounds. Little was recycled here. She was human garbage carried to the dump. 2. The first time. Was there a once? The dream surely began with an original, yet she had the sense, the first morning she awakened, remembering, that there were more she had not remembered, a sensation of return, blurred but convincing. She lay on her back in the rutted center of the bed, the valley that made her doubly conscious of being alone. One of her braids had come unpinned and lay coiled across her throat like a warm black snake. Usually a sense of repetition among waking was a waking too. Again bills, again hunger, again pain, again loss, again trouble. Again no Claude, again no Angelina, again the rent due, again no job, no hope. But now she tasted in her morning mouth something of sweet. The wan light leaked through the window that gave on an air shaft between buildings. No, no, mamacita, no agalo. Something fell hard upstairs. She shut her eyes. Under the smooth surface of sleep, what drifted? Face of a young man, hand outstretched, pointing to something, trying to take her hand. Young man of middling height with sleek black hair to his shoulders, an indio cast to his face. More than her, even. Eyes close together, black and shaped like turtle beans. Long nose, cheeks clean-shaven, skin smooth-looking as hers. Had been. Never again. The smooth bronze skin with the touch of peach, the hint of gold. How beautiful her skin had been. Chicanos were more apt to call brown skin beautiful today than when she had that perfect skin. La gente de bronce. Depression rose like fog in her throat, and she rolled over, began to cough. Coughing shook her hard. Riding on a back road in the cab of Tio Manuel's truck, with dust stretching an enormous plumy tail behind them for miles across the parched land. She groped for the squashed pack, still one, two cigarettes, lit it, sucked the sweet smoke and coughed more, and then, feet on the floor, stood. Her sight prickled out, then cleared. Cold floor. She fumbled into her shoes, bowed out on the sides with age. She would love to have slippers. Yes, silly, fluffy slippers. Then she saw tiny baby slippers pink on Angie's feet. Present from Luis, who called himself Louis. Prick. My brother the Anglo. Angelina 7 years, 4 months, 22 days, 8 hours. She sucked smoke hard, bursting into coughing and padded into the kitchen to face the day already bleeding at the edges. Straighten, clean, tidy, make perfect the rotten surfaces. Her welfare worker, Mrs. Polcari, came today. She had a breakfast of coffee, light and sweet, with a scrap of stale bread dunked in it, the heel of the last bread in the house. Then carefully she figured her budget, refigured after every trip to the superette, brought higher prices. She was still hungry, but she played her stomach an old trick
and drank 2 cups of hot water, washing out the last good taste of her coffee cup with it. Then she cleaned her 2 tiny rooms, slowly and thoroughly, made the bed as smooth as it would go, even picked out of the pretty wine bottle with dried grasses and flowers in it, a few whose stems had broken. At the picnic, whose souvenirs they were, Nita, just beginning to walk, had fallen asleep exhausted in Connie's arms. She had sat on the blanket, burning, transfigured with holding that small, sweet-breathing, flush-faced morsel. An orange and black butterfly had lighted on her arm, and she had remained so quiet, hunched around Nita, that for several moments the butterfly stood flexing its wings, opening and shutting those bright doors. At 11, the knock. Mrs. Polcari was slim, with short brown hair smooth as a polished wooden bowl to her cheeks. Today she wore silver earrings with little green stones that might be jade. Large hazel eyes with long sweeping lashes looked out surprised from gold wire-rimmed glasses. She had once asked Mrs. Polcari why she didn't wear contact lenses and been rewarded with a cold stare. But such pretty eyes. If you had the money, a young girl like her, why not? Her large, ripe mouth opened to a glitter of good, regular white teeth when she, very occasionally, smiled. Girlish, modish, like one of those college girls she used to see when she had worked for Professor Sylvester. Mrs. Polcari smelled of arpège. Today, Mrs. Polcari was pushing a training program that sounded like someone's bright idea for producing real cheap domestic labor without importing women from Haiti. I don't know, she said to Mrs. Polcari. When you've been out of a job so long, who'll take you back? Cleaning some white woman's kitchen was about the last item on her list of what she'd do to survive.
You're too negative, Mrs. Ramos. Look at me. I went back to work after my children started school. I didn't work all those years.
How come you had children so young? You got married in high school? How unusual for a white woman to have children before she was 18.
Mrs. Polcari made a face. Don't butter me up, Mrs. Ramos. I didn't get married until I was 26. My mother was sure I was going to die an old maid.
How old are your kids then, Mrs. Polcari?
The older boy is 10 now. The younger just turned 8.
So she had to be at least 36.
After Mrs. Polcari left, she stared in the mirror over the sink, touching her cheeks. How did they stay so young? Did they take pills?
Something kept them intact years longer, the women with clean hair smelling of arpège.
The women went on through college and got the clean jobs and married professional men and lived in houses filled with machines and lapped by grass.
She had not looked that young since before Aunt Helena was born.
Envy, sure, but the sense too of being cheated soured her, and the shame of being second-class goods, wore out fast. Shoddy merchandise.
We wear out so early, she said to the mirror, not really sure who the we was.
Her life was thin and meaningful we's. Once she had heard a social worker talking about Puerto Ricans, or them, as they were popularly called in that clinic, as were her people and similar clinics in Texas, saying that they got old fast and died young. So the student doing her fieldwork assignment shouldn't be surprised by some of the diseases they had, such as TB. It reminded her of Luis talking about the tropical fish he kept in his living room, marriage after marriage. Oh, they die easily, those neon tetras. You just buy more when your tank runs out.
At least her door pride kept her cleaning for Mrs. Polcari, who was not subject to the same physical laws, the same decay, the same grinding down under the scouring of time. Let Mrs. Polcari look down on her as a case with a bad history, a problem case. But no dirt would Mrs. Polcari find on the chair she set her little behind on, and no dirt would she find on the table from which she would sometimes agree to drink a cup of instant coffee with no sugar. After 2 days of scrubbing floors for the city, welfare work program, she woke very early with morning pain low in her back, but found herself smiling from sleep. La madrugada, daybreak, a word that always left honey in her mouth.
that taste of sweet. The face of the young Indio, smiling, beckoning, curiously gentle. He lacked the macho presence of men in her own family, nor did he have Claude's massive strength or Eddie's edgy combativeness. His hands, as they clasped hers, however, were not soft. Shaking hands? Absurd. Warm, calloused, with a faint chemical odor. "What should I call you?" the voice had asked. High-pitched, almost effeminate voice, but pleasant and without any trace of accent. "Connie," she had said. "Call me Connie. My name is Luciente." Strange that she had dreamed in English. Me llamo Luciente. Shining, brilliant, full of light. Strange that with someone obviously Mexican-American, she had not said Consuelo. Me llamo Consuelo. "Come," he had urged, and she remembered then the touch of that warm, gentle, calloused hand on her bare arm, trying to draw her along. Mostly she dreamed in English, but even yet she had an occasional dream in Spanish. Years ago she had tried to figure out the kinds of dreams she had in each language, during her precious nearly 2 years at the community college when she had taken a psychology course. She should not have drawn back timidly from the young man with his high, pleasant voice and his workman's hands. She should have sidled up to him and rubbed her fat breasts against his chest. Even in sleep, she got nothing. She rubbed her arm idly where his warm hand had touched her, coaxing. She had taken to dreaming about young boys. Maybe as she got older, the boys of her dreaming soul would grow younger and more beardless, slender as matches. She rolled over, began to cough, to choke on phlegm. Cursing, she spat into a square of toilet paper and reached for the crumpled pack on the chair. Then she froze. Her fingers, that scent. She smelled her arm. Yes, her arm gave off that chemical on Luciente's fingers. The hair rose on her nape. Idiot. They'd soon be locking her up again. So she'd got her arm in something, probably cleaning that office, and dreamed about it, like making the ringing of an alarm into a bell tolling. The phlegm she coughed up was brown, a little blood from her throat. That's what she ought to be worrying about. She was too nervous to stop smoking, even though she knew it was hurting her. Oh well, a taxi would run her down before she could die of cancer. A mugger would bash her head in. She would get cancer from eating garbage on the little money from welfare. Her neighbor, Mrs. Silva, knocked on her door shortly after she came back from shopping, from buying 2 rolls of toilet paper, bread, bananas, spaghetti, eggs. She wanted hamburger, but she hadn't the money for meat. Her niece, Dolores, called Dolly, was on Mrs. Silva's phone. Luis is oldest by his first marriage. Luis had got married a lot, and by every wife he had kids. Her favorite was Dolly, who was 22, plump and sweet as a candied yam. When Dolly had to get hold of her, she called Mrs. Silva. Dolly asked her to come down to Rivington Street, and she grabbed her old green coat and her battered plastic purse and headed for the subway. On the express down to Brooklyn Bridge, she had a little piece of luck. As she was getting into the car, she saw a ballpoint lying at the foot of a seat, and when she tried it, it worked. It had the name of a Midtown stationer on it and wrote with blue ink. She had not had a pen that worked in months. She had to write her letters in pencil. Now she would write in ink, the way it should be. Tonight, with her new pen, she would write to both her sisters. She tucked it carefully in her purse before she changed to the QJ train, checking that the tape was still making a repair so the pen would not slip out. She also picked up a Daily News that a man had left in his seat. At Essex and Delancey, she headed north to Rivington, aware, with a heavy lopsided sense of Norfolk a block over, where she had lived that year with Angelina in one room, that bad year after Claude had been sent to prison. That room like a box of pain. Dolly had found it for her after she had been kicked out of the apartment she had shared with Claude. 3 big rooms with her own bathroom, just 2 blocks from Mount Morris Park. Dolly had lived then with her husband on Rivington, where she lived now with her daughter Nita.
and the occasional presence of a rotten pimp, Geraldo. There was a bodega where Connie used to try to get credit till her check came. There was the liquor store she had known too well, with its racks and racks of cheap, sweet wine. It was steamy hot in Dolly's apartment. It always was. Nita was eating in a high chair, getting to be too small for her, finishing coconut instant pudding, and putting most of it into her mouth by now. Ahora, comes como una santa. Connie hovered over her grandniece. She eats real neat now. She's such a good girl. Give me a smile, Nita. Hazme los ojitos. Yes, qué preciosa. Dolly's face was swollen with tears, and she rolled up the ruffled sleeve of her blouse to show a bruise. Some John did this to you? Geraldo did it. Why do you put up with him? He's bad to the core. Dolly sighed and rolled a joint in the licorice-flavored paper she liked. You know how when I got back from San Juan, you told me I was carrying? Connie nodded, accepting the joint. As she let the smoke seep out, she said, You knew it already. You wanted a baby real bad. I still do. I went, got one of those tests. I haven't had my time since then. What did the test say? Dolly patted her belly. I told Geraldo yesterday. He starts yelling at me that it's by some John. He starts hitting on me. He makes me so sick. He makes you go with men, and then he puts you down for it. It's his kid. You came back from Puerto Rico with that baby. She had known as soon as she saw Dolly. Dolly drew herself up. The Johns are a business thing. Don't put it down. I make good money. I don't bring the Johns here. I do them in hotels or at Geraldo's. Listen, every woman sells it. Jackie O sells it. So? So how do you like it with them? It's a job. Dolly sucked in the smoke, glowering. The minutes thickened between them. Finally, she sniffled. You hate yourself, you hate the trick. I never met one woman yet who didn't hate every stupid trick. Leave him, Carita. Leave him. Never mind him. He's not worth your little fingernail. He's smart, Connie. His mind works like that. She snapped her fingers. He has style. The other whores all stand on their heads to catch his eye when he comes around. I thought, why not have a baby with him? Then I can quit. It'll be like it was before, only better. A man respects you more if you have his baby. Why not? So you didn't take your pills in Puerto Rico? I left them here. I didn't even put them in my purse. I thought, too, it might be lucky, a baby made on the island. I want to have this baby, Connie. Why not? One child is lonely. Why not have another? You're a good mother. You quit this whoring and have the baby. He won't let me. He says I gotta have an abortion. No. Connie banged her fist on the table. A strange gesture for her. Dolly stared. You have it. Tell him to OD and sell his body to the city for rat bait. You come live with me. I'll help you with the children. I'd love that. You know it's the truth. The phone rang. It was a John. Dolly ran off to the bathroom to fix her face and get herself together. Connie kissed her, fussed over Nita for a couple of minutes, and then reluctantly picked her way down the stairwell. In the street, a damp, jagged wind off the East River scraped her face. She pulled her old green coat closer. The lining was gone. She felt high and loose with the grass, too stoned to endure the subway just yet. She decided to walk all the way over to the Spring Street stop on the IRT and take the local uptown, even though it was 10 blocks of walking. In a playground on Elizabeth, some little girls were playing red light, green light. She hunched against the wind, not deciding to walk closer, to stop and stare, but finding herself pressed suddenly into the fence. Brown-skinned, mostly, about the right age. And she would be one of the lighter, one of the shorter girls. Eddie, her father, had been light and short. She could be that lean, quick one with the black hair and creamy skin and big love-me grin, getting caught and making a big show of kicking herself. Yes, the girl who kicks herself would be mine.
Two men wheeling a cart on the sidewalk looked at her, and one spoke laughing to the other. Tears were rolling down her face. Rotten dope making her sentimental. Crazy Connie. She started to walk while the street bellied out before her. With the sleeve of her coat, she tried to rub her face. The tears ran from her sore eyes, faucets that would not be shut off, warm and wet over her cheeks. She turned onto Prince and sat down in a doorway on a cement step.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.